Who was a candidate who lost that you wish would have won?
My man, Charles Booker. When Charles lost, man, I feel like November of 2016, man. I felt I felt very disappointed. Yeah. You know, I think, you know, he was a great candidate. I started to learn about him when he first, you know, started running in the race, you know, then he picked up and he got national attention. You know, so I kept looking at that race. You know, obviously we know establishment got behind Amy from day one. You know, they pump all that money in. And again, like the progressive movement came in late, you know, AOC, Bernie, even Elizabeth, you know. I don't understand why we always wait for a candidate to pick up, you know, to pick up some national attention for us to endorse. So I was very disappointed, but I'm actually excited for the future for him. I think he has, you know, someone that going to continue to fight. And I think he has a really good platform for Kentucky. And I mean, if we wasn't in COVID, I would have probably traveled to Kentucky to volunteer for the campaign. So I was there. I wish he would have won.
Nice. Izzy.
Yeah, I have to go with some Elis Lopez. I mean, we had a chance here, you know, given the fact that Elliott Engel basically fell like a rock. You know, we already have AOC in place. We had a chance in the Bronx, at least, to show the world that, you know, we are one of the most progressive counties in the whole country. Because every House congressional district would have been run by a progressive if she would have won her race. So that was devastating. I think we had a chance to make a real statement there. I mean, obviously, you know, we have two out of three of our districts who are now, you know, held by progressives, which is amazing. I think we are still sending a message, but that would have been the, you know, 3 for 3. I mean, that would have been amazing. That would have really shown New York, you know, the state, the city, and the rest of the country that we are super progressive as a county.
Awesome. Awesome. Carlito.
For me, one of the guys that I really like is Alan Grayson. He came into the stage as a unapologetic progressive, and he made a lot of waves one time when fighting for Obamacare, and he said the Republican plan, which it was none, so he said is to not get sick, but if you do get sick, then die quickly. And that caused an uproar.
Oh yeah.
And the part that I was most upset about him losing, it's not just that he lost, is that, you know, the Democrats establishment like to talk about protecting your people, but they basically, when he was running for Senate to take on Marco Rubio, they endorsed a guy that used to be a Republican and then changed to Democrat in Patrick Murphy. And most of the money that he got when he was running, it was from like his dad. His dad put like $500,000 into his own campaign, another million into Democratic coffers. And that's what got him in there. You know, it was a guy with a lot of money, and they pushed him to defeat Alan Grayson. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, he went on to lose to Marco Rubio anyway.
Yeah.
So if he would have been in there, he would have had a better chance, I think. But we were shooting ourselves in the foot because, you know, the Democrats, they just rather lose to a Republican than to win on a really progressive platform.
Yeah. The interesting thing about Alan Grayson was that I believe, if I remember correctly, he kind of take over Bernie's spot in the House as far as being able to have a record amount of amendments. And he was able to, you know, they said that about Bernie. He was the amendment king. And Alan Grayson had that about himself, which unfortunately, though, for him, he was never a media darling. When he did that stunt that you just talked about, it was really looked down upon. You know, it really looked like, you know, in Congress, you got to have a lot of, you know, dignity and respect for your colleagues. While when he did that, he didn't get a lot of positive press. It's like the anti-AOC. Like AOC could do no wrong, and Alan Grayson could do all the wrong, you know. So, unfortunately, he didn't have that going for him.
Right. So this is the part where we also shoot ourselves in the foot, because when that happened, they compare him to, I forgot his first name, Wilson, the guy that during the State of the Union, he told to Obama, "You lie."
You know? Okay.
So they compare him to him in that way. But the thing with Wilson was that the Republicans embraced him. He fundraised a ton of money over that. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, we want to be all goody two shoes and not support our people when he's not even lying. He wasn't even lying.
Yeah.
And but it wasn't completely full of decorum and grace. Decorum, so we gotta, yeah, you know, so we have to, you know, throw him under the bus. So that's upsetting.
Exactly. So the person that I would have loved to see run is Brent Welder. So I'm cheating a little bit. he didn't run in 2020. He ran in 2018 as a Justice Democrat. And I thought he did an excellent job back then. Well, what impressed me more and why I'm bringing him up right now is just recently we had the DNC platform convention or committee where they were voting on different motions, and he voted or tried to put on the table to not to ban corporate super PACs donations.
We need to neutralize corporate influence first within our party that is preventing us from living up to our platform, our ideals, and being a true party of the people. The party of the people cannot put profits ahead of people and remain the party of the people.
And he got a lot of pushback from the Biden delegates who they ended up tabling the motion. And I got to give a shout out to Status Q, Jordan Sheridan, who brought this to my attention because I didn't watch the whole convention, but he definitely had a clip on this. And the way he did it made me so proud, and you could definitely tell that he is a true progressive. He's a true guy, and I really wish he would have ran in 2020 so he could continue to build his brand, but I hope that he jumps back in the race at some points and jumps back into the fight because he would be a good candidate. All right, Gabe.
And Case, just to add on to that, with the Brent Welder race, he ended up losing to a corporate establishment back candidate that to this day has proven not to be progressive. So that's just that there.
Not at all. I got to say, she was one of the two first Native Americans to join the Congress, which is great. But here's identity politics rearing its bad head, where that's what they really emphasized. Like, they were literally saying, why are you voting for the first Native American or one of the first Native Americans? Well, this is why. Because he was the progressive. He was a white guy, which is not popular nowadays, but he was a progressive. He was would have been the one fighting for universal basic income during COVID, for Medicare for all during COVID. He would have been a strong voice with AOC, with Jamal Bowman, who's coming in hopefully, well, definitely in the next cycle. So we got to start putting identity politics to the side and really look at the issues and look at the policy.
So for me, my candidate, I'm going to switch it up. I was thinking of somebody else, but I don't want to send them bad energy through the universe. So I'm going to change my candidate to Tulsi Gabbard. And I'm going to talk more about Tulsi Gabbard because if you look at policy, if you wanted to create a candidate that would be perfect to take the country, it would be Tulsi Gabbard. She checks all the boxes. She's a veteran. She's a woman. She's well-educated. She's progressive in policies. If you want to look at her policies and say, well, maybe she's for certain wars but not others, in that case, she becomes more of like a global centrist versus the centrists in this country that are conservatives. So if you look at somebody that really has potential, she attracted a lot of reasonable right-wing folks and a lot of independents and a lot of progressives. And the attacks that people have levied against her pretty much don't stand. She had the whole media against her throughout this whole campaign trying not to give her shine. If she would have just got one of the boosts that maybe Kamala Harris got or Amy Klobuchar got, like five boosts, or Pete Buttigieg got a couple boosts, if she would have got one or two of those boosts, she definitely could have been in the conversation making noise, but they just kept her out of it. They called her an Assad apologist, Assad toady, all these things that are pretty baseless.
And hold on, don't shrug off things no, like...
This is not a debate now, this is my time. So so all of these things, she didn't get any shine. And then as soon as she drops out, because of COVID, she wanted to stay in, but she drops out because of the pandemic and endorses Biden, which is the quote-unquote right thing to do. I disagree with that, but she endorses him. Everyone's fawning over Tulsi. Look at her, she's so graceful. She's so this, look at it. All the stuff that they just said about her, you could tell is disingenuous. It was disingenuous. They were making disingenuous arguments. And then as soon as she toes the party line and does what they think is the right thing, they're going to fawn over her and applaud and forget about everything else. Versus when you look at somebody like Bernie got an endorsement from Joe Rogan, and it was, how could you dare accept that endorsement? So if you hold that same standard, when Tulsi endorsed Joe Biden, they should have been like, oh, how could you accept her endorsement because she's so terrible. But she's not terrible. She's a very reasonable, awesome politician. She's still an active servicewoman. and a member of Congress. I mean, it's like if you put in a lab to come out with a perfect candidate, you would get Tulsi Gabbard.
Okay, hold up, Gabe. The question was, who lost? You wish won. You trying to tell me that you rather she have won over Bernie? Is that what you're saying?
Over Biden.
We got instructions on this question specifically not to say Bernie, so I had to switch it up to her. I voted for Biden. I voted for Bernie in the primary. Oh. But if you ask me who am I sad that lost, I'm sad that she lost. You know, in hindsight, Bernie, again, he just let him beat up on him. And as much as I loved his policies, he couldn't defend them. We talked about that last time.
Yeah. So. But he is more progressive than Tulsi.
Yes.